So let's take a scenario. There is a file and you want to give the read access to bunch of users, say 5 users. So you need to go to that user and give the access, or go to this file permissions and add that user to the file permission. So that will be very easy. And suppose take there are 100 users. So adding each user to the file permission will be very difficult. So giving permission to a resource for each and every user is very time consuming, and it's very bad. So making certain users into groups helps a lot. So what does this mean? Means we can group all CSE first year students. So it may contain 200 of first year students into one group and make resource access to that group. So there is a file like textbook PDF and you want to give the read access to all these students. Instead of adding 200 users to that file permission, all you can do is you can group all the CSE first year students into one group, and you can just add that group name into this file permission, so that all the CSE first year students will get the read access to the PDF file. So this is very simple than adding all the users. So this is what we call a grouping. Similar or certain users into groups makes things very easy, and each group can have seed to identify uniquely. There are some distribution lists that cannot have seed, but we will deal with the group that have seed because we are doing normal Active Directory. We do not want to go in depth, and these are just like fundamentals. So each group have the seed to identify uniquely, and also there is a one problem with the groups. What if there are so many groups? So many groups, and if you want to add the group to the file permission, then it will be very time-consuming task, just like adding user to the file permission. So that is one of the disadvantage of the groups. So the only disadvantage arises because of large number of groups. So if there are many groups, then adding every group to the resource will be again time-consuming. So what we can do is we can nest those groups based on the roles. We can add users based on the roles and create nested groups. So what does this mean is, say we have the file name flag.txt. So this is the flag text file, and we can create two groups. And one is for flag underscore read, and another is for flag underscore redirect. So these two groups have the read access to this flag file, and flag underscore redirect have the redirect access to this text file. All we need to do is add these groups to this flag underscore read group or flag underscore redirect group. Suppose I have the CSE first year students. If I want them to only read this file, then I can add that whole group to this flag underscore read, and that's it. The whole students can only read this flag. Or I can add them to this redirect. I can just simply add the whole group to this group, and everything will be fine. If I want to change the permissions, I can just move that CSE first year students group from this redirect to read, and that will be very simple. This is called role-based access, because you can remove the users from your CSE first year students based on the roles. Because every student is equal, right? So like it's like equal object. There is no some priority or like that. Because each and every student gets the same role. That is why it's called role-based access control. And we can remove groups and users from their groups based on role. So these students are similar roles, and they have like same access to every other student. That's why we can group them and add it to these groups. So flag.txt have the two groups, that is flag underscore read and redirect. Now if CSE second year students want to access this file, I can just add that group into this group, and that's it. Everyone can access this flag.txt file. So that is very simple. This is a role-based access control. And there are many types of the groups, like local group, domain local group, and etc. But we do not want to go that much depth. But this is just fine for normal Active Directory purposes. So guys, we have seen the groups. Now let's go to this Windows Server and create the new groups. Click on these tools and click on Active Directory, Users, and Computers. So you get these users, right? So we have this administrator user and user one guest. You can also click on this type to filter the groups. So similar groups will be on the one side, and you can type this one. Click on this one. You can see here all the users are listed here. So what you want to do is right click on this and create new group. And you need to put the group name. Let's say CSC1. CSC1 stands for CSC first year students. And you can see here the group scope: domain, local, global, universal. So domain local will be particular to that domain, and global will be for the forest, and universal will be any forest. You can add any users for this, for the whole forest. You have two or three more forests, you can add the users of this to this group. Let's keep this as a global because we want to use this group entire our forest. And you can see the group type, security and distribution. It's better to keep this as security because it will have the SID, that is SID, and for distribution it won't have SID. So let's keep this as security as default, and you have given the name CSC1 and click on OK. Now as you can see here, the group CSC1 has been formed. Now right click on this, click on properties. You can also add to another group. You can add a group to this another group. We have seen this as a nested groups. So for now let's click on properties, and you can see the general, this is the description of the group. You can also change this. So you can click on this members, and if you want this group to be member of, you can add to another group. And you can see the managed by. Here you can have the description of the administrator or group head, and click on this members and click on add. Now you can see we need to search the users or the objects. You can say user one. So upon clicking user one, click on this check names to get the exact logon name. Check on names. You can see the user one in brackets, user one @ home lab dot server, that is this server, and click on OK. Now you can see this user one in this. Now click on apply and click OK. Now CSC1, if you go to members, you can see the user one is the member of the CSC1. So if I perform any operation, it will affect the user one. You can send the emails, you can put the security permissions like file access permissions to this group, and it will reflect to all the users in this group.